Good afternoon, everyone. So my special thanks to Rohit sir and Zeiss team for giving me this occasion to present a keynote address. We all are aware that how this smile has captured the refractive market since last 4 to 5 years. I think in majority of the centers, this forms around 50% of our refractive practices. And in any high volume surgeon hand, the procedure hardly takes 1 minute. It gets over within two and a half minutes. So I will be talking about the smile procedure, how I handle the patient from his entry to the hospital till his first follow-up visit. The first and foremost important thing is we need to understand the patient first as soon as he approaches us for a refractive procedure. Majority of these patients who come for refractive surgery are in the age group between 20 to 25. At this age, they are very ambitious, meantime aggressive also, and they are trying to settle down in their life. They want a procedure which gives them highest quality of vision and in the same time which is very, very safe on their eyes also. So we need to understand the real necessity of this glass revision. Is there any occupational demand for this? Are they understanding the realistic expectation of the surgery? And we should also give special attention who is paying for the surgery. Are they just influenced by the advertisements or the Google, or they just come to a doctor or no? Whether the parents are agreeing or not, this has to be a family discussion. And there are some subset of patients who are just gone through the various websites, understanding the adverse effects more than a doctor. We need to spend more amount of time talking to them regarding the procedure. And another subset of patients, it's very easy because they already know about the brand doctor and the brand surgeon. It's easy for us, no, not much time to spend on these subset of patients. Once these patients agree for the procedure, it's like any other routine surgery. We need to do the vision checkup, refraction by a good optometrist whom we believe in always. If there are any accommodation issues, we have to go in with cyclopegic refraction, corneal imaging, either op scan or pentagon, whatever we believe or whatever we have. Tear film in terms of shimmers and Tibet, abrometry, fundus examination, IOP, and disc evaluation is very important. If at all, if the patient undergoes a barrage, the patient is taken for smile, 48 hours later, if he undergoes 360 degree barrage, I prefer to do refractive procedure 1 week later. Once the patient finalizes to go in for the refractive procedures, once he is suitable, I offer always smile as the first procedure to him. I always talk about the benefits of time, in telling him that it is minimally invasive, there are no flap related complications, we can correct high ranges of power, everything happens in a single machine, in a single step. And we give in the scientific details telling that the biomechanics is good with when compared to other procedures. The dryness factor is very good with smile procedures. And I say no to smile in these sort of patients whenever hyperopic patients come, myopia around 0.75 or 0.5, whenever there is oblique astigmatism and thin corneas less than 490 microns, and I offer the other procedures. Once the patient decides to go in for surgery, the first and foremost thing is, I just show him the video how the smile procedure is done. He explained the importance of green light fixation. If the patient is hyper excited about the surgery, I prefer to give a tablet Alprox 1 day prior to surgery, and automatically the question comes, sir, what so if I move while you were developing the section? I tell him, if you move your eyes within the first 4 or 5 seconds, I may convert into femtolasic. If it happens in the 10 to 15 seconds of the rest time, I may re-talk and go ahead with a smile. And majority of the patients do cooperate, and section loss with surgeon's experience becomes very, very less. And on the surgery day, the most important thing is the data entry. We have a trained and loyal optometrist who is always doing the good work. So even in spite of busy schedule, we need to verify the details. And anesthesia drops, I prefer to put 5 minutes prior to the surgery. I don't want that fluid to be within the sac. That can itself become a cause for suction loss. And for selection of the patient interface, if the corneal diameter is less than 12 mm, I prefer to take S cone. And if the corneal diameter is more than 12 mm, we prefer to go with a medium-sized cone. And intraoperative data entry, I think everything software has, we go into that export mode and do. Importance has to be given to this energy setting. If you see here, it's around 32. I think Ramathya sir was explaining in the morning. The amount of energy what we deliver with Visumax onto the cornea is between 120 to 170 nanojoules. At the setting of 32, we apply around 155 to 160 nanojoules onto the cornea. if the lenticule separation is very difficult with 32, we may increase the energy to 34 or 36. What happens if we increase? There can be more amount of inflammation, apoptosis or edema which can happen, but which subsides with the steroids. If it works well with 32, we can still reduce on to 31 or 30 and go ahead with the procedure. Otherwise, it remains prefixed for rest of the cases. And once the patient is brought onto the table, we explain him to open both eyes, look into the green blinking light. I have a habit to start counting 15 seconds in the reverse order. Once the cornea applanates by 60%, I dock it at that time. I don't want too much of compression to happen upon the cornea, and then I activate the suction. Once the suction is activated, we have seen a lot of videos. We know the first the posterior cut happens, then the side cut happens, then we get the cap cut, then we get the side cut. Initial days, we would take around 4 mm, and most of the times, I land up doing 3 mm. Side cut incision 2, I usually never try. I land up between 3 to 4. Once the laser is applied, the patient is brought onto a beautifully inbuilt microscope of the Zeiss microscope. This is very, very important. Here, we should be very careful while identifying the side cut. If at this point, if we try to loosen up some epithelium, that itself can become a cause for discomfort which may last up to 6 to 8 hours. If you precisely separate it up, the wound will sit in 2 to 3 hours. Patient feels it as a painless procedure. Small amount of epithelial loosening, yes, he feels it as a painful procedure. Identify the antral plane, identify the posterior plane, do a windshield wiper movement. You can see small amount of resistance there. That energy setting was at around 32, which varies from machine to machine. Complete it separately. Go to the posterior plane. Make sure that you have completed, separated thoroughly. It's happening in a very single movement. Hardly takes around 40 to 50 seconds. Pull out the lenticule. A drop of anesthesia and a drop of antibiotic on this. Postoperatively, I prefer to use prednisolone 4 times per day for a week and antibiotic 4 times per day for a week and lubricants 4 times for 2 months. On follow-up visits, majority of the patients do remain happy if you have done a very good clean surgery, seen for the best correct visual acuity, see for any residual refraction, and if the patient complains of any issues, you initiate them accordingly. Thank you.